Over the past few videos, we've been looking at quite a number of the aspects of .NET dependency injection. We've been looking at the typical way you use it in an ASP.NET application. We've been looking at how you can manage the scope, the lifetime of the various objects that you inject using things like transient or singleton or scoped. But this week, I just wanted to look at a few final features that didn't really fit in anywhere else, a few miscellaneous ideas, and see what use they can be. So as a reminder, let's just go back to our web application and look at how that worked. So we had this idea that I have a number of book reviews. So we've got different reviews for different books there, multiple reviews for Dr. No, multiple reviews for Emma. And we've got the one page that just displays the raw data. And then we've got the summary page that gives us the averages of all the reviews for each particular book. So pretty simply done. And it was done with various services that were injected. So we had a DB context that was actually getting that data from an SQLite database. That was injected into a book review repository, which then just gives us back the raw data so we can get all of the book reviews there. And then we had another service, this aggregator, into which was injected that repository. So we got layer upon layer of injection, and it just calculated the summary that was displayed. And then in the controller, we had both of those injected, and we used one of them just to display the raw data and the other one to display the summary. And in fact, it's here that we have the first of the concepts I wanted to look at, which was if you start injecting a large number of different services, then you end up with quite long parameter lists on your constructors, which can start to get a bit messy. With two of them, it's probably a borderline case, but certainly what I'm about to show you, as soon as I got three things, I think I would be switching to this slightly different approach. And so what we do is this. We get rid of the actual injection of the individual services, and we replace that with a single parameter of a thing called iServiceProvider. And if we just get hold of the namespace, we just call that provider. And that really gives us a single point of access to everything that dependency injection provides. So if we just start using this, we could in here do something like provider. And then if you look at the methods, the interesting one it's got is this getService. Now, in fact, we don't usually use getService directly, but I'll just show you it briefly. The thing about getService is it takes a parameter of the type. So in order to get hold of that, we'd have to say type of, and then in this case, the interface. So say, give me back whatever's been configured to be the service that we want when we ask for that interface. You can see it's still not happy because one other thing we've got to do, get service returns an object. So we have to cast that to our interface. And then once we've done that, you can see that part of it's happy. So that would work and it would follow whatever the injection rules we've specified, but it is quite messy code. And so you can get things working a lot better if you just get hold of some extension methods. And we need to get hold of Microsoft.extensions.dependencyinjection. And if we do that, then we'll see on our provider, we've had some extension methods added that make life much easier. So we've now got an extension method getService. And the nice thing about it is it's a generic that allows us to generically specify the service type. So if I pop that in there, it now copes with all those issues of getting the type and casting it back and everything's okay because the return type of getService is whatever the generic type is. So we could put that one in there and put that one in there with obviously the other interface, and then we've got that working pretty much exactly the same as we had it before, but we've only had to pass one parameter in, and now we can take control for ourselves as to exactly when we do the injection. When we had it previously with those interfaces passed directly in, effectively this code was happening just before the constructor call, not inside the constructor call, so that's all that's happening. The other method that we have here that you might want to use, rather than get service, we've also got a thing called get required service. And you can see, once I put that in there, it's perfectly happy. And it works in almost the same way. The difference is, if we do get service, and let's just pop a break in there, and then go back to our startup, and let's forget to configure one of those. So let's just comment out the aggregator and then run that up. We can see when we hit that break that the repository, that's fine because we still had that, that the aggregator is now null. So get service gives you back the service if it's there and gives you back null if it's not there. Whereas get required service, basically, if it's configured, will work in exactly the same way, but if it's not configured, it will throw an exception, which we see there. There's no configuration for iReview Aggregator, so we throw the exception there. So it's up to you. If there's a situation where it might not be there and that's reasonable and you want to test for that, then go for get service. If you definitely want it, go for get required service. And in fact, when we said that this is called just before the controller constructor, if you've passed the interfaces in directly, that's actually the get required service that's called then, because you do get the exception thrown. So that was the first thing I wanted to show you, the way that we can save having those long constructor parameter lists. Next thing we're going to look at is just a simple idea, the fact that we don't always have to inject via an interface. So all of the examples we've seen so far, we have this situation here where we're saying if somebody asks for an iBook Review Repository interface, give them a Book Review Repository object. If somebody asks for an iReview aggregator, give them a review aggregator. And then over here, where we do the get required service, that's where we do ask for those things and get the objects. And generally speaking, it's a good idea to do it through an interface because it means you can have alternative implementations, particularly, as we saw in the earlier video, if you're doing unit testing, you can have a mock object instead of the real object, as long as it implements the same interface. But there are sometimes situations where, although you want injection, there is no prospect, no concern at all about that variability. And you don't want to inject an interface, you want to inject the actual object. In fact, we've already got one example of that, because when we inject our DB context into the repository, you can see there it's not an interface, we're actually injecting that directly. And so it can happen. So let's suppose that in our controller, we didn't want the interface review aggregator, we simply wanted to say we want a review aggregator. It would work just as well if we'd put that as a parameter in there. It doesn't matter which way you're doing it in those terms. Now, obviously, at the moment, that's going to fail because we haven't configured anything for that. We've configured it for the interface. So that will just give us the problem of the required service not being there. We haven't done the configuration. But just following the rules we already know, it's pretty simple. This says, if they ask for this thing, give them this thing. So what we're saying is, if they ask for a review aggregator, give them a review aggregator, which is what's been asked for there. And so if we do that one now, then that works perfectly fine. It is, you might think, and you'd be right, a bit long-winded, because actually there is a overload on this where we can just say the one class name. So if you're simply saying, when they ask for this, give them this, then that's the way that you can do that. Last thing I want to look at is just some of the questions of actually what can we inject things into. And the simple answer is pretty much anything in any circumstances in an ASP.NET application where an object is being created and you yourself are not directly saying new whatever it is and therefore have access to the constructor and could therefore pass your own parameters in. If the constructor is hidden away when it's being called, then it's almost certainly going to be available for injection. And there's a few other places as well. So one, for example, is we do our configuration of the injection in configure services. And remember, that is called before configure. But configure itself is actually injectable. And in fact, things like this, the environment, that's being injected because we've asked for it. It's not obliged to be there, although it normally is. But if I were to put here something like I book review repository and then just put repos on there, then in this case I can't really imagine what use you might have for it, but it will get injected following whatever rules you've set up. So when we hit that, we can see we've got a valid repository being injected with the DB context. So that's one place where it works. We've seen that it works on constructors. That's going to be the main place that it's done. Just occasionally, and I'd really be careful about using this, but you can actually inject in an MVC application directly into the view. So here's our view where we're getting our book reviews coming in as the model from the controller, and then it's the controller itself that is having those services injected into it. But we could actually just maybe here say at inject, and then we give it the interface typically that we want. So we could here say I book review repository. Need to get hold of the namespace for that. So that's going to be that dot services. So there we've got that. So we've there said, I would like you to give me whatever's configured for that interface. And then we can just declare a variable here, my repos, and that has done the declaration for us. And then if we wanted to, we could take that, and rather than using the model that's come through, we could just say in here, repos.all. And if we run that up, we'll see it still works in the same way because it's injected our repository directly into the view. Now, it has to be said, certainly in that example, that is a very, very bad idea. Clearly, the repository is the business of the controller. The idea is we don't want business logic in our view, and therefore that's not something we should be doing. Just occasionally, though, you may have situations where what you want to inject is related to nothing to do with the business logic, but simply with presentation, with formatting, and that sort of thing. For example, you might want to do some kind of very specialized locale dependent formatting in different countries, that sort of thing. And that might be the sort of thing that's worth injecting directly into the view because it's the business of the view. But I would be very careful. Whenever you put that at inject in there, ask yourself very carefully, isn't this really something that should be in the controller? Other things that we can inject into, things like view components, if you ever use those, where we've essentially got a kind of mini pairing of a controller and a view. Similarly with razor pages, similar sort of thing, you can inject into those. You can even actually inject into tag helpers. But once again, a bit like what we just saw there with the injecting into the view, tag helpers are purely display logic, so I'd be, again, a bit dubious about that, but sometimes it can be the right thing to do. So that was it, just a few extra miscellaneous features related to dependency injection that hopefully will round off what we've looked at. If you haven't seen the early videos, do take a look at those. Do subscribe to be notified about new videos. Do click like, and I'll see you next time.